एवं अप्यंग सर्वेषां देहिनां देहयोगतः काला वयवतश्चन संति भावा जन्मादयो सकृत अथ दस एशाम ऑफ दोस कर्म फ्रूट ऑफ एक्टिविटीज कर्तृणाम ऑफ द परफॉर्मर्स भोक्तृणाम ऑफ द एंजॉयर्स सुख दुख यो ऑफ हैप्पीनेस एंड डिस्ट्रेस नानात्वम वेरिएगेटेडनेस अथ मोर ओवर नित्यत्वम परपेचुअल एक्सिस्टेंस लोक ऑफ द मटेरियलिस्टिक वर्ल्ड काल मटेरियल टाइम आगम वैदिक लिटरेचर्स रिकमेंडिंग फ्रूटिव एक्टिविटीज आत्मनाम एंड द सेल्फ ट्रांसलेशन फॉर ऑल द वर्सेस कंबाइंड माय डियर उद्धवा आई हैव दस एक्सप्लेन टू यू परफेक्ट नॉलेज देर आर फिलोसोफर्स हाउएवर हु चैलेंज माय कंक्लूजन दे स्टेट दैट द नेचुरल पोजिशन ऑफ द लिविंग एंटिटी is to engage in fruitive activities and they see him as the enjoyer of the happiness and unhappiness that accrue from his own work. According to this materialistic philosophy, the world, time, the revealed scriptures and the self are all variegated and eternal, existing as a perpetual flow of transformations. Knowledge, moreover, cannot be one or eternal. Because it arises from the different and changing forms of objects. Thus, knowledge itself is always subject to change. Even if you accept such a philosophy, my dear Uddhava, there will still be perpetual birth, death, old age and disease, since all living entities must accept a material body subject to the influence of time. Purport. In this verse, according to Srila Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur, Lord Krishna speaks the following to Uddhava. My dear Uddhava, I have clearly established the actual goal of life in the instructions I have just imparted to you. There are those, however, who challenge my conclusion, especially the followers of Jaimini Kavi. If you are favorable to their understanding and thus do not accept my instructions, then kindly hear the following explanation. According to the followers of Jaimini, the living entity is originally and naturally a performer of fruitive activities and his happiness and distress are derived from the fruits of his own work. The world in which the living entities find their enjoyment, the time during which they enjoy, the revealed scriptures that explain the means for achieving enjoyment and the subtle bodies through which the living entities experience enjoyment all exist not only in manifold variety but also eternally. The living entity need not develop detachment from material sense gratification either by seeing the temporariness of individual material objects and situations or seeing the material world as an illusionary creation. According to such materialistic philosophy, material objects such as garland, sandalwood or beautiful women are temporary in specific manifestations but perpetually exist through the natural flow of creation and destruction. In other words, although a particular woman's form is temporary, there will eternally be beautiful women within the material world. Thus, by carefully executing fruitive rituals according to religious scriptures, one can maintain enjoyable contact with women and wealth life after life. In this way, one's sense gratification will be eternal. The Jaimini philosophers further say that there never was a time when the world did not exist as it does today, which implies that there is no supreme controller who has created it. They claim that the arrangement of this world is real and appropriate and thus is not illusory. Moreover, they say that there is no eternal knowledge of an original perpetual form of the soul. In fact, they say knowledge arises not from some absolute truth, but from the differences among material objects. Knowledge, therefore, is not eternal and is subject to change. The assumption hidden in the statement is that there is no spirit soul who possesses eternal constant knowledge of a single unchanging reality. Rather, the nature of consciousness or knowledge is that it undergoes constant transformation. They state, however, that eternality is not refuted by the perpetually transforming nature of the consciousness. Consciousness perpetually exists, they say, but not in the same form. Thus the followers of Jaimini conclude that the transformation of knowledge does not negate its eternality. Rather, they state that knowledge eternally exists within the perpetual nature of its transformation. They therefore naturally come to the path of regulated sense gratification rather than the path of renunciation. For in the state of mukti or liberation, the living entity would not have any material senses, and thus the transformation of material understanding would not be possible. Such philosophers consider that the achievement of an unchanging state of mukti would stunt or paralyze the natural activity of the living entity and thus would not be in his self-interest. The path of nivritti, aiming toward renunciation and transcendence of the material world, is naturally not interesting to such materialistic philosophers. Excepting for argument's sake, the validity of such materialistic philosophy, one can easily demonstrate that the path of regulated sense gratification brings many unwanted and miserable results to the living entity. Therefore, even from a materialistic viewpoint, detachment is desirable. Material time is divided into different sections such as days, weeks, months and years, and by material time the living entity is repeatedly forced to undergo the miseries of birth, death, old age and disease. That such real miseries occur everywhere throughout the universe is well known. In this way, states Srila Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur, Lord Krishna has pointed out the defect of materialistic philosophy to Uddhava. We may further elaborate that if one falsely accepts the atheistic philosophy of Jaimini and his innumerable modern followers, then the living entity perpetually remains entangled in the anguish of birth, death, old age and disease. This bogus atheistic philosophy encourages material gratification as the only logical goal of life, but the living entity will inevitably commit mistakes in the execution of regulated sense gratification and eventually go to hell. The Supreme Personality of Godhead, Lord Krishna, personally tells Uddhava that this materialistic philosophy is false and irrelevant to the actual self-interest of the living entity. Om Ajnana Timirandhasya Jnananjana Shalakhaya Chakshurum Nilitam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha Shri Chaitanya Manobhishtam Apitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupa Kadamayam Dadati Swapadantikam Vandeham Shri Guru Shri Jutapada Kamalam Shri Gurum Vaishnavamsha Shri Rupam Sagrajatam Sahagana Raghunathanvitam Tam Sajivam Sadvaitam Savadutam Parijana Sahitam Krishna Chaitanya Devam Shri Radha Krishna Padhan Sahagana Lalita Shri Vishakham Vitamscha He Krishna Karuna Sindho Dina Bhando Jagatpate Gopesha Gopika Kanta Radha Kanta Namostute Tapta Kanchana Gaurangi Radhe Vrindavaneshwari Vrishabhanu Sute Devi Pranamami Hari Priye Vancha Kalpatarubhyascha Kripa Sindhubhya Evacha Patitanam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo Namaha Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhar Srivasadi Gaur Bhaktavrinda Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. My dear Uddhava, I have thus explained to you perfect knowledge. There are philosophers, however, who challenge my conclusion. They state that the natural position of the living entity is to engage in fruitive activities, and they see him as the enjoyer of the happiness and unhappiness that accrue from his own work. According to this materialistic philosophy, the world, time, the revealed scriptures and the self are all variegated and eternal, existing as a perpetual flow of transformations. Lord Shri Krishna, in concluding some very important teachings to his very dear friend Uddhava, is also providing warnings so that his dear friend and in general all those who listen to this conversation are also guided from weeds. In as much as it is important to sow a seed, as much important as cultivating the soil in which you sow the seed is also to understand, acknowledge and work in consciousness of the weeds that may grow around the seed. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu has referred to many such weeds. They could be philosophical distractions, they could also be distractions to the senses, they could be mental distractions in the form of offenses to devotees. Here especially the distraction or the tendency of the living entity to get entangled in Dvivarga is explained in the Manusamhita, Manusmriti. There is a mention of Dvivarga, Trivarga, Purushartha, and then Srimad Bhagavatam in the culmination is talking about the Purushartha Shiromani. So what is Dvivarga? Dvivarga is a tendency to accept Kama and Artha only. I'm only interested in things that either gratify my senses, fulfill my desires. Kama may not be only gross, it can be very subtle. It can be Kanaka Kamani Pratishta, the desire for enjoyment, the desire for fame, name. And yes, it has a place in the Vedic system where according to the Varnashram, a person within his Swabhava, within his Swadharma, he fulfills his desire without intervening, without creating problem in the desires of others. So there is Kama and there is Artha, Artha which is required for the fulfillment of Kama. However, when only one subscribes only to this Dvivarga, Kama and Artha, Manu, he says, this can be a cause of entanglement. And therefore, he says, one has to bring in the balancing factor of Dharma. Now, interestingly, this the entire discussion of Jaimini, which is being referred to in the details in the purport here, begins with Athatho Dharma Jigyasa. Vedanta Sutra begins with Athatho Brahma Jigyasa. The Purva Mimamsa of Jaimini begins with Athatho Dharma Jigyasa. That yes, in your pursuit of Kama and with the accumulation of Dharma, in your accumulation of Artha, be very conscious of Dharma. Be very conscious of regulations. Yama Niyama, where Yama and Niyama in many places are talked of as foundations of Dharma. However, there is a problem. So it's very interesting verse. It says, Dharmartho vichyate shreya, kamarthai dharma evacha, artha eveha va shreyas, trivarga iti tustitaha. Trivarga is when there is dharma balancing kama and artha. And in fact, the injunction of Manu is that parityajye dadartha kamau yau syata dharma varjitau. If kama and artha are in harmony with dharma, with the injunctions, anukulyasya sankalpa pratikulyasya varjanam, if they are in harmony with dharma, you may accept them. But the moment they start offsetting dharma, you should parityajo. Parityajertha kamau. Artha and kama should be given up. Now this is the foundation of evolution of understanding. That yes, everything is important, but there is a prioritization. Without prioritization, one can get entangled. However, prioritization does acknowledge that kama is required. Krishna says in Bhagavad Gita, dharma viruddho bhuteshu kamosmi bharatarshava. That kama which is not against dharma, I am that. So Manu is saying the same thing here. Parityajo, give up artha and kama if it opposes dharma. And therefore, when we talk of the four regulative principles of freedom, it is regulative principles of freedom. Why? Because it's parityaja, that which actually impedes your freedom in practicing dharma. And especially the freedom in practicing Bhagavad dharma. which is realizing our pure eternal loving relationship with Krishna, which Krishna is more than eager to reciprocate with us. It really doesn't make sense for us to keep him waiting. Krishna is waiting in the form of his holy name, in the form of transcendental literature, in the form of every breath that actually we take. It's Krishna's mercy. Every day we wake up, one can be surprised that I actually woke up. It's Krishna's mercy. So dharma is what is brought out, athato dharma jigyasa, in the purva mimamsa. What is mimamsa? Mimamsa, which is being referred to here by Jaimini, mimamsa basically means reflecting. So it's a tradition. It's a tradition, and just like when you have a tree growing, similarly when understanding of the Vedas grows, then you have these different schools of philosophy. In the first canto of Srimad Bhagavatam, there is this description of Srila Vyasadeva's despondency. And in that context, it is brought out what all Vyasadeva had done and in what context was he despondent. It's explained that Vyasadeva could see deterioration in the age of Kali, and therefore out of compassion, out of great concern for the people, he had divided the one Veda into four. And not only that, he had also entrusted upon different great sages, which includes Jaimini. The mention of Jaimini is there as well, and Prabhupada writes many beautiful purports there. So it said, tadarga veda dhara pailaha samago jaimini kavihi vaishampayana evaiko nishnato yujasamyuta. So nishnata, they were a different nishnata, very expert kavis, very thinkers. Kavi also means thinkers. Paila Rishi became the professor of Rigveda, Jaimini the professor of Samaveda, Vaishampayana became glorified by the Yajurveda, and then Angira was entrusted with Atharva Veda. This is the first canto description from the chapter 4. Now, Prabhupada writes in the purport there that the different Vedas were entrusted to different learned scholars for development in various ways. Again, why do you need development? You only need development when something that is obvious has started becoming hidden. And many of these points are resurfaced through conversations. Most of these scriptures are conversations where a person who is appearing ignorant, like you have Taittiriya Upanishad, there are questions being asked, and that which is obvious is being brought out based on Vedic authority as well as that which is obvious. What Krishna tells Arjuna in Bhagavad Gita makes Arjuna realize that my mind is actually flickering. Chanchalam hi mana Krishna pramathi balavadridam. And Krishna says asamshayam mahabhava. So therefore Krishna Arjuna samvad, it's a samvad, it's a process of churning through which that which is natural, that which is innate to every living entity actually becomes glorified, becomes established and is very clearly constituted so that one can follow. So therefore, when there is confusion, when there was too much Buddhism, and especially when there was too much of Kama and Artha, Jaimini was entrusted with bringing in the Dharma element. However, it's explained that all these learned scholars in their turn rendered their entrusted Vedas unto their many disciples, grand disciples and great grand disciples, and thus the respective branches of the followers of the Vedas came into being. Now what was Srila Vyasadeva's state after doing all this? So Vyasadeva had assimilated all this, edited all this for assimilation by less intelligent men, and out of great compassion he thought it wise that this would enable men to achieve the ultimate goal of life. So his goal was what? Very clear. He wanted everyone to progress in their path to Godhead, to their swarupa, Shruti Gochara. And it's explained that the Shruti Gochara means for the sake of understanding. Shruti is the Vedas, Gochara for the sake of understanding. And thereafter he also compiled Mahabharat, illustrate the whole concept again through stories. But Despite all this, Srila Vyasadeva, evam pravrittasya sada bhutanam shreyasi dvijaha sarvatmakenapi yada yada, at when he did all this, at that time, what happened? Na tushyad dhridayam tataha. He was not satisfied in heart. So an adjective is often used to qualify the nature of these compilations and thinking. Dissatisfaction at heart. We'll see the same thing coming out in conversation with Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and Sarvam Attacharya, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and Prakashanand Saraswati and his followers. Dissatisfaction of heart. And it actually requires sincerity to acknowledge this. And we find that even great sages like Mahatmas like Sukadeva Goswami, they acknowledged that they were attracted when they heard the beautiful pastimes of Krishna, those same pastimes which attracted the heart of Vyasadeva. Now, is it that Vyasadeva wasn't aware of Krishna's glories? It's very interesting that the entire Mahabharata, every time Krishna makes an entry into the between the Pandavas or in the palace, the way Krishna is glorified resembles one of the verses from either Bhagavatam or from Bhagavad Gita. For example, when Krishna met the Pandavas during the Vanavas, now it was a long time since he met them. Krishna was not even there when the attempt to disrobe Draupadi had been undertaken and the Pandavas were helpless. However, the Pandavas don't start with a complaint, and Draupadi certainly doesn't start with a complaint. She says, Krishna, everything opulent in this world, all living entities, your empowered persons may be like pearls. However, you are the thread binding everything together. In that painful situation of hers, where day and night the only reflection she was is, why did this happen? What can be done to give justice? In that painful situation, she glorifies Krishna. And then, of course, she also expresses her anguish to Krishna. Krishna, where were you when they disrobed me? So, Vyasadeva has actually glorified Krishna in the Mahabharata. He has glorified Krishna directly or indirectly. The same words that she spoke, Draupadi spoke to Krishna. Krishna says, Mattha parataram nanyat kinchidasti dhananjaya mai sarvamidam protam sutre maniganayava. He says, I am the sutra, combining the pearls together. And this has been already elaborated by Srila Vyasadeva in the Bhagavad Gita. It was all prior to this. So he was aware. Still his mind was not satisfied. Thus the sage, being dissatisfied at heart, at once began to reflect. So this reflection is a process that has continued. It is not that Mimamsa was devoid of reflection. Mimamsa also, the word Mimamsa itself means reflection. However, when there is reflection devoid of grace, Lord Krishna's special grace, when there is reflection devoid of complete experience that the Supreme Lord wants to give, then that reflection can also have very limited fruits. And therefore the word incomplete. Purva Mimamsa, what does Purva Mimamsa mean? Purva means before. So Purva Mimamsa is reflection on the Vedas before Upanishads. Because Upanishads, like Ishavasya Midam Sarvam Yat Kincham Jagat Yam Jagat, Ishavasya Upanishad, Taittiriya Upanishad, all these Upanishads begin with serious reflection on how the living entity, he has an eternal responsibility with the Lord. The Lord, by His grace, can remove Hiranmayana Patrena Satyam Sthapitam Mukam Tattvam Pushan Pavrano. That the Lord, by His grace, can remove the covering on the eyes of the living entity. But when Purva Mimamsa means the Upanishads are somewhat belittled, or their scope is not understood, then there's Purva Mimamsa. They are only Dharma, Artha and Kama. And that is being referred to in this verse. And Krishna is warning Uddhava. The Srimad Bhagavatam was spoken so that one realizes Purushartha Shiromani, Krishna. And Krishna certainly wants that this message remains intact as he is bringing a closure to his instructions, which is so beautiful. It's Krishna's love. It's all out of Krishna's love. When Vyasadeva was feeling unsatisfied, there was Narad Muni. And here, Uddhava is being guided by Krishna, so that that complete satisfaction is not lost. It's cherished. Because when we don't value what we have, then it's a matter of time. We don't even realize we have lost it. Sometimes we are searching, right? Walkman, there was a Walkman, I used to hear nice Harikatha or some jukebox, and you're searching for it, you don't get it at all. Why? For a long time we didn't value it. So Krishna certainly wants to emphasize the importance of cherishing what has been obtained. The Purushartha Shiromani. Purva Mimamsa is when you're devoid of Upanishads. Uttara Mimamsa is when you see the Vedas, the Vedic rules and regulations, the Karmakanda also in the light of the Upanishads. Understand the goal of life. And therefore there have been many personalities who followed up, as is mentioned here by Srila Vyas, in the context of Srila Vyas, many thinkers after Jaimini, they developed on it. Kumarila Bhatta is one of them, and some of us would have heard, you know, conversations Kumarila Bhatta had with the Shankara, and with Shankaracharya also. So the understanding evolved. It's not that the knowledge wasn't there, but it was the collective understanding, it was the means by which people could be enlightened, that evolved. And then of course there was Adi Shankaracharya, and we have many great Vaishnavas who followed thereafter. It's a very interesting description in the Madhya Leela, and it's also interesting to know who spoke this. So it is said
Vyasa Sutrera Artha Acharya Koriyache Achadana Yehoya Satya Shri Krishna Chaitanya Vachana.
The conclusion is that the import of the Vedanta Sutra is covered by the imaginary explanation of Shankaracharya. Whatever Shri Krishna Chaitanya Mahaprabhu has said is perfectly true. And then the description goes on. It says, this is all spoken by none other than Prakashananda Saraswati. It's very interesting. In this series of verses, Prakashananda Saraswati is actually summarizing the different schools of thought that led to Adi Shankaracharya's teachings, which Prakashananda Saraswati himself was a follower of, proponent of. And it was in fact Prakashananda Saraswati who had asked Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, why are you just chanting and dancing? Why don't you take the Vedanta Sutra Darshan seriously? Why don't you discuss that? So here we see the transformation of Prakashananda Saraswati. So he says, Shankaracharya was very eager to establish the philosophy of monism. Therefore, what he did, he provided a better alternative, a better understanding than that of Jaimini's Purva Mimamsa or the later Uttara Mimamsa, which included the understanding of Upanishads. However, for him, the ultimate source was just the impersonal Brahman. And he says that Bhagavata Manile Advaita Nayaya Sthapana Ataeva Sava Shastra Koroe Khandana. If one accepts the personality of Godhead, automatically there is a khandan of any other distractive philosophy. It's actually coming to the point that Chaitanya Mahaprabhu drove through his very example, not just his words, but his example, his existence, his compassion. He's saying, the nature is that when one doesn't have purity in consciousness, when one was not specially graced by the Lord, he may try and establish his philosophy. Anyone who wants to establish his own opinion of philosophy certainly cannot explain any scripture according to the principle of direct interpretation. So he says, Mimamsaka kahe Ishvara haya karmi ranga. Now we might have difficulty understanding the purport in its detail today, but Prakashananda Saraswati kind of gives a summary. He says, the Mimamsaka philosophers, what do they say? Ishvara haya karme ranga. They say the Ishvara is part of karma. Even if there is a God, he is subjected to karma. Karme ranga. So in fact, they have Mimamsakas have a different concept also of something called pravaha, which they say is the connection between one's activity and its results. And that is, it's very impersonal. It's not even Brahman. So in fact, even if there is a God, they are often atheistic, and even if there is God, he is subordinate. So he says,
Sankhya kahe jagatera prakriti karana prasanga.
So while Mimamsaka says that the Lord, if he is there, is subordinate to karma, the Sankhya philosophers, they say that the cause of the cosmos is material nature alone. And then Prakashana Saraswati continues, Nyaya kohe paramanu hoite vishwahaya. The Nyaya people, one of the issues with the Nyaya philosophy is that they also try to make the Vedas subordinate to logic. And in, it was also in that context that Mimamsaka came up saying, no, Vedas are sacrosanct. They, whatever they say must be performed. So Nyaya, what do? They kahe paramanu hoite vishwahaya. That atom is the cause of cosmic manifestations. And then, what does he say? Well, he talks of the school that he himself was following, Prakashanand Saraswati. Mayavadi nirvishesha brahme hetukaya. He says, the Mayavadi philosophers maintain that the impersonal Brahman effulgence is the cause of the cosmic manifestation. And then he goes on to explain other distractions. Patanjala kohe ishvara haya swarupa gyan. The Patanjala philosophers say that when one is self-realized, he understands the Lord. It's not really a distraction, but yet he does talk about the unsatisfactory nature of these levels of understanding. And then he says, Vedamote kahe tanre swayam bhagavan. However, the Vedas very clearly establish that Supreme Lord is the cause of all. And there he refers to Srila Vyasadeva. Vyasadeva had summarized all of these in the Vedanta philosophy. And the fact that absolute truth is a person is there in Vedanta philosophy, but to further establish this, the Srimad Bhagavatam is very important. This is what is being again told by Prakashanand Saraswati. Now, Prakashanand Saraswati is soon going to request Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, please you now shed light on the Vedanta Sutra. And Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, in his explanation of Vedanta Sutra, through Srimad Bhagavatam, especially focuses on the Chaturshloki Bhagavatam, where he explains the eternal nature of the divinity, its relationship with Krishna, and to see anything separate from Krishna is Maya. Ritertat yat pratiyeta na pratiyeta chatmani tad vidyat atmano maya yatha bhaso yatha tama. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu explains in his commentary on the Brahma Sutras to Prakashanand Saraswati and his followers. Now it's all interesting. Where is this all happening? So I'm going to do a little bit flashback, right? How did this all happen? How was this culture of establishing something that is completely satisfactory? How is this propagated? So it's actually a culture. If the goal is to connect everyone to Krishna, the goal is to inspire in every living entity pure love of Godhead, how does one do that? There is a very nice Sri Vaishnava scholar. He says that the entire Vedic system is about having a warm heart and a cool head, and not about having a cold heart and a hot head. The Vedic discussions never happen with a hot head, and it is never based on indifference. There is compassion. Even through the entire process of evolution of understanding, there has been compassion, and that was Srila Vyasadeva's compassion. That was Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's compassion. It's very interesting, this entire episode of Prakashanand Saraswati is, though it is the results of this episode are in the Madhya Leela chapter 25, the actual details are in the Adi Leela chapter 7 in the context of Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and his five features. There it's explained that Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and the and his associates, they were distributing love of Godhead everywhere. Patra patra vichara nahi nahi sthana sthana ye yanha paya tanha kore premadan. They were only distributing love of Godhead, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and his associates, especially the Pancha Tattva. And then it's explained that the flood of love of Godhead was spreading everywhere. Everyone was inundated and chanting the holy names. Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. However, what happened? They were very happy with all this. However, it's explained, Mayavadi karma nishta kutarkika gana nindaka pashandiyata paduya dhana sei sab mahadaksha dhana palaila. So there were certain people whom they wanted to give, but they were so expert mahadaksha that they were avoiding this mercy of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Mahadaksha dhana palaila. The impostors, fruitive workers, false logicians, blasphemers, and also the non-devotees, they were very expert in avoiding Krishna consciousness. And the devotees of Lord Chaitanya, the Panchatattva, they were aggrieved at heart that they are being deprived. Therefore, as I said, mentioned earlier, it starts with warm heart and a cool head. Because to understand philosophy, just like we talked of a Purva Mimamsa and Uttara Mimamsa, the whole Vedic discussion happens through a process called Purva Paksha and Uttara Paksha. Purva means before and Uttara means after. What is Purva? Purva Paksha is making the other person reflect on his own philosophy. We'll see how Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu made Prakashananda Saraswati reflect on his own philosophy. Because only when a person realizes that there is something greater to understand, something that is more transcendental to what my level of understanding is, only then a person actually opens up his heart. And as we have heard many times, that which is spoken from the heart can reach the heart. So it started with the compassion that these people, they're working so hard to avoid us.
So therefore, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu said, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu thought, केहो केहो एदाइला प्रतिज्ञा होइला भग्न तासबाद दुआइते प्रतिभा किचुरंगा.
I have tried to catch everyone, but some of them have escaped. Therefore, what will I do? Kichuranga. Ranga means trick. I will devise a trick. And in this context, right in the Adi, Krishna's Kaviraj Goswami explains why Chaitanya Mahaprabhu took sannyas. He took sannyas because he wanted to devise a trick. And he took sannyas in the Advaita Sampradaya. He was holding a ekadanda. There was actually no rule of the Advaita Sampradaya sannyasi that Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was not following. In fact, he was only having prasada at the house of Brahmanas. Of course, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, in that process, he also elevated the consciousness of the Brahmanas. He put a condition, I will only have prasad at the house of one who is a master of 10,000. Brahmanas were in anxiety. And then Chaitanya Mahaprabhu explained, one who chants the holy name of the Lord 10,000 times at least. Hare Krishna, 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 Hare Hare, Hare Rama, 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 Hare Hare. In this way, he followed the rules and regulations of a sannyasi. Yet, he elevated the consciousness of people in general, even in his following the rules. So, it starts with a warm heart. It starts with this compassion, cultivating this spirit of compassion for others. The compassion that Vyasadeva had, the compassion that the Panchatattva had. And then it's explained that when Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, he went to Varanasi, which is really headquarters of these people whom he wanted to deliver. On his way, he observed, yet he kept distance. When he came back from Mathura, he was at the house of Chandrasekhar Acharya. And he would go to the house of Tapan Mishra to accept prasadam. However, he would avoid conversing with any of these Mayavadi sannyasis. Until the devotees came to Lord Chaitanya and said, "Oh Lord, your character is impeccable. Your consciousness is impeccable. But still these people are criticizing you. They're criticizing that you're chanting and dancing like a madman. They're criticizing that you're not undertaking the study of the Vedanta. We have already heard what Prakashananda Saraswati spoke later. But this is where it began. The concern of the devotees. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, he just smiled. He understood the concern of the devotees. A Maharashtrian Brahman came to Lord Chaitanya and said, "Oh Lord, I know you don't accept any invitation like this, especially when it involves conversing with other sannyasis. However, I have invited to my house many of these sannyasis from the Shankara, that's the Advaita, and I would like you to come home as well." And after hearing the devotee's concern, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu accepted. It's a very beautiful description by Krishna's Kaviraj Goswami. When Chaitanya Mahaprabhu went to the house of this Maharashtrian Brahman, it's explained that he offered prostrated obeisances to all the sannyasis assembled there. He chose a place, he first washed his hands and feet and then chose that place where everyone washed their hands and feet, sat there. When Prakashananda Saraswati, his followers, they saw, he naturally inquired, "Oh sannyasi, why are you sitting in a place it's very interesting. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu not only sat there, he was so effulgent. He was radiating effulgence. So he attracted the hearts of everyone. The sannyasi asked him, why are you sitting in a place which is contaminated, where everyone washes their hands and legs?
Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, did he talk of this philosophy then? Well, what did Chaitanya Mahaprabhu said?
Well, I belong to not a very high class of sannyas order. I mean, in one sense, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was keeping distance, but at the same time, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was talking about the Kesha Bharati Sampradaya, which wasn't considered as elevated as a sampradaya of the Advaita Sampradaya that Prakashan Saraswati, the Saraswati Sampradaya. Now it's explained that Prakashan Saraswati, he caught Chaitanya Mahaprabhu personally, tried to bring him and seat him in the middle of all the devotees, all the assembled sannyasis. And then he said, I know your name is Sri Krishna Chaitanya. You are a disciple of Keshav Bharati. You are glorious. You belong to our sampradaya. Why then are you engaged in chanting and dancing like a madman? Why are you avoiding us? Why don't you see us? So Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, out of great humility, he expressed, my spiritual master, he found me to be a murkha. Guru mora murkha dekhi karila shasan. Krishna mantra japi sada yahi matra sar. Murkha tumi tomara nahi vedanta adhikar. You are a murkha, you don't have adhikar on Vedanta. Now it is not that Chaitanya Mahaprabhu did not study the Vedanta, because that's what we'll see. The entire Madhyalila chapter 25 is about Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu explaining the Brahma Sutras through the light of Srimad Bhagavatam. But this was Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's genuine humility, that my guru saw me not adhikar, and therefore he told me, chant the name of Lord Krishna. Harer nama, harer nama, harer nama eva kevalam. Kalau nasteva, nasteva, nasteva gatir anyatha. And I just followed his instruction. I just sincerely chanted the holy name of Krishna. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. And what was the transformation? Chaitanya Mahaprabhu said, since I have been chanting the holy name, I am not able to control myself. I am going mad in ecstasy. I expressed this to my guru. And what did my guru say? He said, well, it is working. This is what is the transformation you are undergoing is but natural. In fact, my guru said, please share this Maha Mantra with others. I am simply trying to follow his instructions. And therefore, he explained to Prakashanand Saraswati, please don't misunderstand that I am chanting and dancing like this on purpose. It is actually the influence of the holy name. Prakashanand Saraswati and his followers by then had, their hearts had been transformed, melted by the association of Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and his behavior. However, they still had a desire that they engage with Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu in the discussion of Vedanta Sutra. So it explains that what you have said is all true. Only one who is favored by fortune attains such love of Godhead. And there is no objection to your being a great devotee of Lord Krishna. Then Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu said, oh scholars, if you don't object, can I say something about the Vedanta philosophy? Because he sensed their desire to engage in that conversation. And what was the effect of his polite inquiry? It was a polite inquiry, can I speak? And iha shuni bole sarve sanyasi ragana toma ke dekhi aiche sakshat narayan. They of course felt that Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is sakshat narayan. And they, with their hearts, they requested Chaitanya Mahaprabhu to elaborate. And the elaboration of this can be found in both Yalila chapter 7 as well as the Madhyalila chapter 25. The beautiful description on the Vedanta Sutra, the Chatushloki Bhagavatam. And we read further in the chapter 25 of Madhyalila that one of the disciples of Prakashanand Saraswati, after this entire episode, he was engaged in enlightening everyone about the magic that Chaitanya Mahaprabhu had created, both based on his his scholastic presentation, as well as based on his humility and behavior. Now, when this came to the notice of the devotees, they went and reported this to Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, and Chaitanya Mahaprabhu smiled because he knew that transformation had taken place. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu went to the Bindu Madhava temple, and where he heard the chanting and dancing, the chanting of the holy names, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu danced in ecstasy. Now it was the same chanting and dancing that the disciples of Prakashan and Saraswati had at one time objected to and were confused about. But Prakashan and Saraswati's mutt was not very far from the Bindu Madhava temple. They came in to witness Chaitanya Mahaprabhu dance. In fact, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu in this episode tried to restrain himself. He offered his obeisances to the sannyasis and then again engaged in a very beautiful conversation. So the whole Vedic concept is, as we see illustrated, is as much important as the philosophy is the behavior based on that philosophy. And it's actually this behavior we see transforming the hearts of so many devotees. In a very old Back to Godhead edition, this is Back to Godhead in 1979, called A Biography of a Pure Devotee, Satsuru Maharaj very beautifully present some details of Srila Prabhupada's first visit. He was initially in Boston, and from there, at Butler, Pennsylvania, he had wrote a letter to one of his associates, a publisher, Mr. Mehra in India, and asked that, can I get some help in New York? Now it's explained that both Mr. Mishra and Srila Prabhupada, on Mr. Mishra's Mehra's recommendation, wrote a letter to Dr. Mishra. His name was Ramamurthy Mishra, who was based in New York City. This was his Prabhupada's first advent in New York City. And Ramamurthy Mishra, on a phone conversation and a letter, invited Srila Prabhupada. Prabhupada stayed at a very nice apartment that he had been provided. And it was the first Hindu Swami that Srila Prabhupada met outside India, in the US. He looked young enough to be Srila Prabhupada's son. But it's still interesting the way Prabhupada dealt with him. The Dr. Mishra, Murthy Mishra, was a proponent of the same school to which Prakashan and Saraswati belonged. And of course, he was commenting, he had written books on textbook of yoga, psychology, self-analysis and self-knowledge. And he used to speak to an audience every day. He was the host of Srila Prabhupada, yet he had his own following. Now it's explained, he recalls, what is his experience with Srila Prabhupada? The experience that Prakashanand Saraswati had with Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, we can relate to that. He said, actually, Srila Prabhupada came like a medicine in my life. Why? Because I was suffering from very bad health. So poor a health that I would have been knocked down by disease, but Bhaktivedanta Swami knocked down me with love. That is the opening. His Holiness Prabhupada really knocked me down with love. He was really an incarnation of love. My body had become a skeleton, and he really brought me back to life. His cooking, and especially his love and devotion to Lord Krishna. I was very lazy in the matter of cooking, but he would get up and have everything ready. And he said he would cook like a chemist with such precision. And he said, I never saw him offering rotis. It was actually Krishna Prasad. That is the experience with which he recalls Prabhupada's cooking. The mercy of the Lord. He recalls the childlike innocence of Srila Prabhupada, yet he does recall that Swamiji, when it came to philosophy, was uncompromising. He had several discussions with Dr. Mishra. Sometimes they would be going in the car, and a former disciple of Mishra, she recalls that sometimes the debate would get so animated that I would get scared. But the next moment, Srila Prabhupada would be so comfortable talking to him. Now, the way Prabhupada also conversed with Dr. Mishra is interesting. He asked with questions. If each one of us is actually the Supreme, he said, he would ask, then why is a Supreme now struggling in the material world? And to which Dr. Mishra said, the Supreme has been covered by illusion. And then Srila Prabhupada would again challenge him. If we are non-different from the Supreme,
then how can we be covered even temporarily by illusion? And we can seek this kind of conversation many other places. And Srila Prabhupada then went on to elaborate based on the Bhagavad Gita, when at some point of time Dr. Mishra was completely checkmated. However, Dr. Mishra, there was only one instance where he invited Prabhupada to speak to his disciples. Dr. Prabhupada spoke uncompromisingly and in fact pointed out the nonsense that Dr. Mishra was speaking. And after that, Dr. Mishra never invited Prabhupada to speak. Yet, he would always request Prabhupada to do kirtan. Now, one very interesting thing that came out in this Back to Godhead article, which really touched my heart from the core, is the way Srila Prabhupada kept on engaging with Dr. Mishra, in fact requesting him to assist him in the mission of Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Dr. Mishra was a Sanskrit scholar. Prabhupada said, I'm doing editing, I'm not a Sanskrit scholar. Can you look at the editing and help? Can we work together? And Dr. Mishra, he recalls with a heavy heart, he says, it's my great misfortune that I did not accept his advice then. I should have actually worked with him. He said, I used to give different excuses for not doing it. So this is the potency of a pure devotee with warm heart, with compassion, yet a cool head, with philosophical conviction. Just to conclude, I mean, we find this similar kind of conversation coming up in the Srimad Bhagavatam, in the Canto 1, Chapter 17, in the context of Dharmaraj, bull, in the form of bull, who was in agony with three legs chopped off by none other than Kali, who was standing with a sword smeared with blood. Maharaj Parikshit, the Pautra of Maharaj Yudhishthir, Arjuna, was present there. And it doesn't require a PhD to realize who has done what. Yet Maharaj Parikshit, out of etiquette, asked this Dharmaraj, please advise, who has brought you in this situation? And what does the bull, Dharmaraj, say in that context? He says that, Navayam klesha bijani yatasyutaha yatasyuhu purusharshabha purusham tam vijani mo vakya bheda vimohitaha. He says, it's very difficult to understand who has caused this calamity upon me, because there are different opinions, different philosophers. And there again, in the purport, Prabhupada brings up the same points that Prakashananda Saraswati spoke. Why different philosophers attribute the result of one's karma to different things? For example, again it's mentioned that Vimamsakas, they attribute everything to karma. Vaisheshika philosophy to logic and so on. However, the behavior of Parikshit Maharaj and the behavior of Dharmaraj is exemplary. Dharmaraj did not point out the cause of his fault, because he knew that, well, there all these different philosophies exist, but in one sense, from an integral point of view, when we look at things holistically, it's very difficult to ascertain. Is it that I am suffering today because of my past reactions? Is it Krishna's grace? Yes, a devotee in his consciousness accepts things as Krishna's grace. Yet it could be exhaustion of one's karma, as Prahlad Maharaj always reflected. Everything good that came Prahlad Maharaj's way, he always reflected, this is exhaustion of my karma. So therefore, he refers that many thinkers who believe that it's very difficult to ascertain the cause of distress. And there Prabhupada says, this is the consciousness of a devotee. The Vaishnavites, the devotees of the Lord, do believe, as explained, that nothing can take place without the sanction of the Supreme Lord. So in one sense, we see in this conversation, though there is a reference to other philosophies, how very practically the philosophy of Krishna consciousness, the philosophy of Krishna being the ultimate cause of everything, integrates all other understandings. It doesn't minimize, it actually elevates all other understandings. Yes, there may be karma. Yes, you can also find a root cause using logic, which someone could have done. There could be immediate cause, there could be a root cause. And Prabhupada writes in the purport that devotee, that's a consciousness in which he accepts, and in that process he transcends. He transcends these arguments as well. So that is the goal of, and see, Srila Vyasadeva, through the entire treat of Srimad Bhagavatam that he has provided to us, he has invited us also to transcend. By reminding that which we are completely, which is our constitutional state. I was with Damodar Lal Prabhu yesterday, and I was sharing with him, sometimes we have problems with cows, because sometimes mother cows deal with their children as if they are not the child at all. Once in a while it happens, in IIT we have had that experience. They will kick the child, throw the child away, run away from the child. How will the child survive?
And it happens once in a while. So of course, Damodar Prabhu was sharing some of his own experiences like this with cows we were around yesterday. And he said, one thing that works, he converses with the cows and explains to the cow the sacred relation that cow has with the small child. And he says, invariably, with 100% accuracy, the cow treats the child as if that's the only property in life after this kind of conversation and treatment. And to the extent that anyone who comes near the child thereafter is kicked by the cow. So what that which is obvious with compassion and with systematic understanding can resurface. Therefore it said, Krishna Bhulia, we have forgotten. But what is Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's mercy? He has simply Krishna, it's like Krishna Surya Sama Maya Andhakar. Let that sun rise and let us open our eyes and receive that mercy with grace, with gratitude. Hare Krishna. Srila Prabhupada ki jai. We just run out of time, I guess.